Okay, so hello everyone. So I will start. I think it's time. So today we are going to talk about supply chain security. And before we start, you can find the QR code at the entrance of the room to have the subtitle live in Chinese or in English. And also on the calendar, you have the slide available both in English but also in Chinese, if it can help you to have a better understanding of the talk. So today we are going to discuss about supply chain security and what is possible to do from a practical standpoint, identifying the risk and the defenses at the build time, but also at the runtime for supply chain security. And before we start, a little bit about myself. So I'm Enguerrand. I have studied 1 year in China at Tsinghua University, and currently I'm working at Ledger on the cybersecurity side. In short, at Ledger, we are doing secure hardware wallets and security products linked to the blockchain and Web3 ecosystem. And as you can imagine, my currently focus at Ledger is to work on the supply chain security. So today we are going to cover different topics. We'll start by why supply chain security is important. After that, we'll discuss about the SALSA framework, what is the goals of this framework, and we'll try to imagine to have some kind of possible milestone about supply chain security, and we will try to have a practical view with an example implementation at the build, but also at the runtime. And we'll try to go a little bit further by talking about hardware security module. So before diving into the content, just a little example of what can be a supply chain attack. So let's imagine you have a standard pipeline of deployments. So on the side, you can see that we have a Git repository with the source code of our application. We are building this source code inside a build platform. This can be GitLab, GitHub, or other solution. This build is pushed to a registry, for example, in the case of a container images. And the registry is used by the Kubernetes cluster to pull the container images. Quite basic. A possible supply chain attack is an attacker getting access to a registry and breaking the integrity of this registry. So the attacker is able to corrupt the registry. So the stuff in the middle between the build platform and the Kubernetes cluster. The attacker may push a new packages or replace an existing packaging. And your Kubernetes cluster is going to maybe pull these images from the registry, thinking that is the correct images, the images that you have built on the build platform, but not. It's going to be the attacker images, and the malicious code is going to run inside your Kubernetes cluster. It's a very common example of supply chain attack. And supply chain security, it's a very important topic. For example, Gartner predicts by the next year, almost half of the organization in the world is going to experiment a software supply chain attack. And I can give you two examples of supply chain attack. The first one from SushiSwap, it's a decentralized platform on the Web3 side, when you can manipulate cryptocurrency. And in this example, a contractor with access to the repository of a smart contract change the code of the smart contract and was able to redirect the cryptocurrency to itself. And here it was linked to an authorized change on a source Git repository, so on the source code, and the impact was massive, more than 3 million of USD of user phone was impacted. And I can give you another example from the SolarWinds attack. Here we are talking about a compromission of a build platform, and here an attacker inject a malware inside the build platform and was able to change the behavior at each build of the SolarWinds software. So was able to inject some stuff for each build of the SolarWinds software. Here the impact was massive, it led to a massive data breach with a lot of US federal agency impacted, and around 20,000 of organization was impacted. And also this is impact a lot the valuation of the company. So it's also impacting the business side. So yes, supply chain security is important. So what is possible to do, it can be interesting if you want to implement some supply chain security, to start with the security level for software artifact framework, SALSA. It's a framework backed by the OpenCSF, so the Open Source Security Foundation, linked to the Linux Foundation like the CNCF. It's a collaborative framework from a cross-collaboration about cross-industry with actors with different interests as goals. And the purpose is to establish a set of guidelines, a set of what is possible to do to improve supply chain security, mainly at the build time. And inside SALSA, you are going to find multiple kind of stuff. you are going to find a list of requirements, of course, but also you are going to find a specification for a provenance. A provenance is like an attestation file where you are going to have some metadata about your software you have built inside your build platform. And the audience for this framework, it's the producer, of course, the people that are doing software, but also the user of the software, because they need to verify the provenance file. And also, it's for the infrastructure provider, because they are in the middle. You can find on the side the link to the website of ELSA, and also the link to the GitHub repository. And inside this framework, multiple threats and attacks are defined. For example, on the source side, if someone is editing code, the source code of your application is going to be an attack on the source side, or if someone is able to bypass the permission. For example, you have an open source project, you have a misconfiguration of your rule for the merge request or the pull request, someone is able to have a review and to have the code merged to the main branch, and inside this merge request, this pull request, he can inject some malicious code. So we are talking here about source attack. But you have also attack possible on the build side, of course. So for example, your build platform is compromised. So someone is able to manipulate the runners that are building your source code and to inject at the build time new code, to remove code, to change the code. Or this can be like the example I've given you at the beginning of the talk, if the package's registry is compromised. And the last kind of threat and attack defined on the SASA framework are on the dependency side. So for example, a common attack can be a typo squatting, so where a malicious actor creates a package with a similar name to a popular library, hoping that a developer will use it. Or it can be a malicious code inside a dependency. So if you're using a dependency, for example, a Python package, and this Python package is attacked by a supply chain attack. So if your dependencies are vulnerable to supply chain attack, you can be vulnerable to supply chain attack. So it can be like a domino effect. So we have covered the major threat and attack defined on the SASA framework. And if you want to find some possible defense to implement linked to this thread on the SASA side, multiple levels are defined only at the build level at the moment. It's the major focus of the SASA in this current version. So as you can see on the slide, we have a first level, build level 1. Here we want to have a provenance showing how the package was built. A provenance file, it's a JSON file, most of the case, with some information, some metadata. For example, your code was reviewed, your code was built inside this runner at this time by this person, it was linked to this Git repository, etc. But here, it's just going to be a file living next to your artifact, next to your build. So it's very easy to manipulate this file. But you are going to maybe avoid to have some mistake, you are going to have a better documentation about your packages. If you want to have a first true level of security, you need to reach the level 2. Here, you are going to still have this provenance file, this big JSON file with some metadata, but you need to sign this file with your key, and you need to generate and sign inside your build platform. So for example, you are going to generate this file inside your GitHub Action pipeline, you are going to generate the file, push the file next to your packages, and you are going to sign this provenance file showing that this provenance file is coming from my organization. And here you want to be protected about the tampering after the build. And the last level, defined in SASA framework, it's the build level 3, and here you want to have a protected build platform. So you want to be sure that your build platform is secure, that no one is able to edit the code at the runtime, that no one is inside your runner, login and do modification. So here you need to protect your platform, you need to have security check, you need to isolate your runner, etc., etc. And here you want to be protected about the tampering during the build. But it's not enough to have a complex view of what is possible to do in supply chain security, so I can propose you some possible milestones linked to supply chain security defenses. So a first level to do first testing can be to try to have the first signature of artifact in local, to have some kind of attestation, to start to monitor the image that you are using on your Kubernetes cluster to find the possible vulnerable images. You maybe want also to check what you are running at the runtime on your Kubernetes cluster. Here, you want to have a first testing of what you are doing. And if you want to have a first good level of defenses, you need to, of course, build your packages only inside your CI/CD pipeline. You need to sign the artifact and the attestation. And also, you need to check at the runtime. And if you want to go to a more advanced scenario, you need to be able to proxy maybe your dependencies that you're using from internet, maybe rebuild all the artifacts that you are using from open source, etc., etc. Here, it's like an infinite amount of work, but you are going to implement a defense in deep for your supply chain security. So that's it for the theoretical part. So let's deep dive on the practical way. So we are going to assume that we are inside an organization with application running on a Kubernetes cluster, that we are building based on GitHub Action, and that we are using open source dependencies for the build. So our packages that we are building is using some dependencies, but also on the Kubernetes cluster, we are running open source solutions like Grafana, Prometheus, or other controllers. And also, we are building open source application. So we have some source code of open source application that we are building and that we are publishing to the open source community. So let's start on the build side. So here we are trying to answer the question, how to ensure that the software deployed on Kubernetes was built within the GitHub Action of the organization. So here we want to be protected about a possible corruption of the registry. And here we are going to implement two stuff. The first is going to be to have a signature system. And the second one is going to have a provenance system about our artifact. So let's start on the signature side with the Sixtor project. So Sixtor, it's an open source project for software supply chain security. It's backed by the Open Source Security Foundation like Salsa. And the goal of this stacks is to provide a simple and secure way to sign software artifacts. And it's linked to a very interesting motto, sign, verify, and protect. We are going to be able to sign artifacts, we are going to be able to verify the signature, and we are going to be able to monitor the signature activity. So we are going to have a way to check what is going on with the signature. And it's possible to do signature of almost every kind of software with Sixtor. You can sign blob, you can sign counter images, etc. And inside the Sixtor project, you have multiple tooling. You have the cosign tool, it's the CLI for interaction for the signing and the verification. You have Fulcio to be able to do the keyless signature authority, I will talk about that just after. And also you have Record, it's the transparent metadata tooling, and here you are going to be able to verify the signature activity. And you have a lot of other tools inside the Sixtor organization, you can find more on the GitHub organization. So with Sixtor, you are able to have two kinds of signature. You have the keyless mode and you have the static mode. The most, dumb way is to use the static mode. So here you are going to generate a private and public key, and you are going to sign your artifact with the private key, and you are going to verify your artifact with the public key. It's very basic, it's not based on ODSA identity, and you can find the CLI command on the slide. But here, you are going to not to be in charge to protect this private key and to be sure that the private key is not leaking. And also, you are going to be at a very basic level of security. If you want to have a better level of security, it's recommended to use the keyless mode. In the keyless mode, you are going to sign your artifact based on the ODSA identity. So for example, you are going to sign your artifact based on GitHub, Google account, or Microsoft. And the default recommendation is to use the keyless mode. It's more secure because you are going to use ephemeral certificates. So I can give you an example of signature system. So let's imagine that inside the GitHub Action build job, we are running the command cosign sign and we want to sign an images. So we have built the images and we want to sign the images. So we are going to run the command cosign sign. It's going to interact with the Fulcio instances to request a certificate for the signature. And it's going to be based on the identity of the GitHub workflow. Here, we imagine that we are doing open source software. So it's possible to use the public instances of Fulcio and Record because we are not issued to leak metadata because it's going to be open source. If you are signing private artifact, private build, you may need to rehost the Sixtor stack, so rehost a Fulcio, rehost a Record because you are going to leak metadata by using Fulcio and Record about your signature. But it's possible to rehost all the stack in local on Kubernetes or to use third-party solution. So Fulcio, we are logging it with ODC identity of GitHub. Fulcio is giving us a signing certificate to sign the images. We are signing the images inside the GitHub Action build job. We are pushing the images on a registry. On the Fulso side, the signature information are pushed to record, where we are going to have a transparency logging about the signature system. And on the end user side, or inside the Kubernetes cluster, it's possible to download the images and the information about the signature. And it's possible to verify the signature based on the record instances. So in this case, the public record instances. So if we are diving a little bit more inside what is possible to do on GitHub Action, you have an example on the slide of what is looking inside GitHub. So we are doing the installation of the cosign tool, quite basic. We are doing the loading of Docker metadata. We are doing the build and the push with the classic action to do that inside GitHub Action. And just after that, we just need to do the signature. So it's going to be based on the OIDC identity of the GitHub workflow, and we are just doing a loop. Cosign sign, we are putting the yes flag to allow the usage of the open source instances, and that's it. We have signed, and it's going to be automatically pushed. But signature is not enough, because with a signature, you are just telling that, yes, this build was signed inside my CI, but you are not adding information about if the build was reviewed, if the code was passing the test, etc. So you want to need to go a little bit further. And to go further, you need to have an attestation system more advanced. And it's possible to use InToto attestation. So InToto, it's an open source framework for supply chain security integrity. It's also backed by the CNCF. And the goal of this project is to have a global view on the supply chain security. It's not only about the attestation part, it's a more global project. The main implementation of InToto are in Python. And it's possible to put the Salsa provenance metadata and the requirement of Salsa inside InToto attestation. And inside attestation, you can put a lot of information that you need and you think that is important for your build. For example, you may want to put information about the people that are building, the information about the runner, if the build is prod ready, etc., etc. You have the link also on the slide to the attestation specification. So if we are looking on a more concrete way, it's going to look like that. So you have an example of an attestation in Toto with cosign. So in order to create an attestation, it's possible to use cosign to sign the attestation and to convert the predicated file inside attestation. In short, so you have the command line to attest and to verify attestation. So first, you need to have a predicated file. It's going to be a JSON file with some data you want to put. You can see that on the side with my data. You are going to put information that you think relevant for supply chain security. You are going to pass this file to cosign. Cosign is going to sign the file to create the attestation and also to link it to a subject. The subject, in this case, is a GitHub container images. But you can also do that with blob or other kind of file. Here, you are going to improve the security because you are going to provide trust information for the end user of your build artifact. So at the end, on the build, we are ending with a signature system running inside the GitHub Action. We are doing also attestation to add more information about the build. And here, we are providing trusted information to the end user or to the Kubernetes cluster. So now let's move on the runtime side. So here, we want to answer another question, how to verify the application provenance running in production. So here, we are going to have two kinds of tooling. The first one is going to be the Kubernetes admission controller. This can be cosign policy controller, Kiverno, or other solution. And the other one is going to be on the OD and detection side. This can be, for example, KubeScape. And here, we want to be protected about another kind of supply chain attack. In this case, for example, a Kubernetes cluster that is using a non-trusted container images. Some images that you see, that we think is not relevant for our Kubernetes cluster. So first, we are going to go on the Kiverno side. Kiverno, it's an open source policy engine for Kubernetes. Again, it's linked to the CNCF. With Kiverno, it's possible to enforce security, compliance, and some policy inside Kubernetes cluster. It's not only about supply chain security. For example, you can put a policy to only have pod with more than two containers if you want. And here we are going to use the feature of Kiverno to enforce policy. The policy in Kiverno are write in like Kubernetes resources, it's YAML file. And here with Kiverno, we can, for example, enforce to only deploy on a Kubernetes cluster signed images. Or we want also maybe to check the provenance file. So only to deploy images with some information inside the attestation. Maybe only images with an attestation telling it's pod ready. Again, on the slide, you have the link to possible policy linked to supply chain security with Kiverno. And here you have an example of a cluster policy with Kiverno to verify images. So here it's an example about signature, but you can do the same about attestation. So here, for example, we are checking all the images that are matching the regex in image references. So all the images are coming from Ledger HQ organization and starting with signed name are going to be checked. The images signature is going to be checked in keyless mode based on the public instances of record. You can find the URL of record at the bottom of the slide. And here we are checking the subject. The subject is going to be the URL to the workflow and the Git ref of the workflow. And we are checking also if the issuer is GitHub OADC provider. And here we want to be sure that we are deploying only images that are signed with the correct information. And we are enforcing this policy based on the validation failure action. And on the other side, we have KubeScape. KubeScape, it's an open source Kubernetes security platform. It's linked to the CNCF also. And here with KubeScape, it's possible to improve the security of your Kubernetes cluster, but also your CI/CD pipeline or source code. And the feature that makes interest for us in terms of supply chain security, it's the Kubernetes scanner. So with KubeScape, it's possible to run scan based on predefined control on some rules, if you prefer. And it's possible to run that from your computer in one-time mode or with a controller running on your Kubernetes cluster. Here, we want to do two stuff. We want to check if we are using registries that are allowed inside our organization. It's possible to define a block list or allow list. It can be a very good first step to check if you are using image registries that you think are not trustable. And also, you can check the image signature. So for example, a good first step can be to check if the images running on your cluster are signed. You have more control available on the documentation of KubeScape. And here you have an example of a policy running. So in this case, we are checking if the signature exists on a Kubernetes cluster. So in this case, we can see that inside my cluster, I have 10 images and 8 images are not signed. And in this case, the signature is checked if the images is signed with cosine or not. And I can see that only 20%, so 2 of my images are signed inside this Kubernetes cluster. So this can be a good first step to analyze if I need to sign more applications inside my organization, or also to contribute to open source to maybe have a signature system on open source dependencies. So at the end of this implementation, we end up with that. So as you can see on the slide, we have a signature system, we have the attestation system, and we are able to do the verification. On the Kubernetes cluster, we are using Kiverno to enforce policy. And we are also doing a first analysis, a first audit about what we are using in terms of images with KubeScape. And also on the open source side, it's possible to allow the end user to check the signature with cosine. So you can check the signature of the artifact with cosine. You can check the signature of the provenance or attestation file. And after that, the end user is also able to check the content of the attestation file. And it's possible to go a little bit further with supply chain security by using hardware security module like we are doing at Ledger. So HSM means hardware security module. It's a physical device, a card if you prefer, on server, designed for cryptographic operation. And with hardware security module, it's possible to have a high level of protection of the root key, of the private key of the certificate that's going to be used to sign all your artifacts, because hardware security card or device are built to resist to physical attack or other kind of attack. And here, if you are using HSM, it's going to be used by Fulcio. Fulcio, it's the certificate authority manager, so it's going to be the tool in charge to generate the signing certificate. And if you want to use physical HSM, you need to rehost all the stacks, about 6 store. So it can be quite complicated, but they are providing a scaffolding chart to deploy that on Kubernetes. It's possible to use an hardware security module, but you can use, for example, ArchiCore Vault, KMS, etc., etc. And here you are going to maybe need to have this kind of setup, because if you are doing private certificate, you maybe don't want to use open source solution, open source instances, because you are leaking information. So you may need to rehost the full source instances and record to keep your metadata about your signature private. And that's it for me today. So I'm open for your question or any remark. And also, you can find additional resources with the TAC security white paper about supply security that was released, I think, 2 years ago. And also, you can put your feedback on your calendar. Thanks. If you have any question. You're going to have a mic, I think.
Cool, thanks. How do you protect for external dependencies? So let's say ingress controllers, service mesh images, and things. Do you, if they're not signed, do you pull them down, rebuild the image, sign it?
So the recommendation in this case is to clone the source of the open source dependencies and to do the rebuild. So this can be quite complex at scale to rebuild all your open source dependencies, but it's the default recommendation in this case.
Hi. So in your diagram, I see you have that, the defense approach on the, for example, the CI/CD part and also the runtime part, but not on the registry itself. So just want to know, so do you assume that, okay, the images are all signed, so they are all secure. So that's why on the registry side, we don't actually need to implement any other control.
Yes, I'm starting by this, by assuming that if the registry is corrupt, I'm going to check on my Kubernetes or at the runtime, and I'm going to see that the build provenance is not matching, the signature is not matching. So I don't care a lot about the registry status. But yes, you can do some security at the registry, on the registry side, but it's going to depend a lot based on the solutions that you're using. If you're using open source solution, if you're using Arbor, if you're using Artifactory. So the defenses at the registry side is going to depend based on your provider. But for example, on my company, we are doing some security check on Artifactory. So we are checking also the signature inside the registry to be sure before allowing to put some artifact inside the Artifactory registry. We are checking the signature also. And this can be a good first step also to do that. Yes?
Thanks. I have two questions. One is I saw the news that Kubernetes has met the SRSA compliance. Hmm? I don't know who did the certification. This is the first question. And second one is you introduced many tools in different phases, like build, publish, even runtime phase. And these software or tools are hosted in different foundations. So I'm wondering who are maintaining these tools and make sure all the tools will be trustful, because they are checking the compliance. Thanks.
Yes, so for your first question, I don't have the answer, sorry. But for your second question, so all these tools are maintained by the CNCF or by the Open Source Security Foundation. So at the end, it's Linux Foundation. And the main tool in terms of security is Cosign, because it's where you are going to trust the signature system. So if you are using the public instances of the 6-store solution, they are releasing a lot of information about the threat model and the security they are doing around the security of the root CI, the root private key hosting inside the public instances of Fulcio. So you can find inside the documentation of 6store all the security process they have, and also the root key, the private key, at the end of this mechanism, if you're using the open source solution, is managed by, I think, 4 people from different companies with different interests inside different countries to ensure that the private key that doing the security of all this stuff in open source are secure. So you can find more information on 6store about that.
Yeah. Hi. I just wanted to ask, since these steps basically add some barriers to release for like new artifacts, so in case you want to do like a break glass release, for example, you don't want to wait for QA attestation, et cetera, is there any mechanism to bypass these, for example, for hot fixes, et cetera, which you might want to put out?
So it's possible to bypass if you want. It's possible, for example, in a new key Verno policy to not match certain kind of container images. But if you are putting a bypass inside your system, you are maybe allowing a suppression attack. So maybe it's not a good idea to have a bypass in place. And also, this system is going to implement inside your build platform. So when you are going to the build of your artifact, it's going to be also signed at the same time. But yes, maybe you want to have a bypass mechanism. So this can be based, for example, that you have a particular key that allows you to bypass, or you are not enforcing the policy maybe on staging, because on staging, maybe you don't want to have a complete suppression security software. But yes, you can do that if you want on the key Verno policy. For example, on the key Verno policy, here I'm doing an enforce, but you can also do an audit. That's just going to report you and to warn you that you are doing something that's breaking the policy, but I'm going to allow you to deploy on the cluster.
To follow up on the break the glass question, how much does this enforce policy actually add to the build time itself? Like, is it
I think
marginal?
Yes, it's marginal. Yes, it's negligible. The signature is going to be quite fast. I don't have precise metric, but I don't see the differences. Most of the time of my build is going to be to build the build the Docker images, and for the signature, if it's taking more than 10 seconds,
yeah,
it's not normal.
So, yeah, there really doesn't need to be a break the glass solution, yes, in that situation. Okay, thanks.
Okay, so the last question.
Hi. So we're practicing GitOps at our organization. One thing that we do is we deploy bundles of Kubernetes manifests into our cluster. So my question is, how can we sign these bundles? Can we use your tooling in SigStore?
You can also, for example, with cosign, you can sign a blob. So you can sign also your Kubernetes resources if you want. If you think it's interesting, it's possible also to sign file.
Okay.
And you can also link a build provenance, link to your file also, to have the signature system.
Cool, okay.
So I think we are over in terms of time, so if you have other questions, I can take the question offline. Yeah. Thanks for your attention.